Right. Hi, everybody. My name is David McKenzie. I work at Ford's Theater on Exhibits in Digital History, and I'm really excited to welcome everybody here today to our little conversation about reactions to President Lincoln's assassination. So what we're going to do today is, on today, the anniversary of John Wilkes Booth's capture, we're going to talk a bit about how people processed Lincoln's assassination back in 1865. So to do that, we're going to draw from a couple of different places. We're going to draw from our Remembering Lincoln website, which you can find at rememberinglincoln.fords.org. This is a website where we have around 850 different primary sources of how people reacted to Lincoln's assassination. Also, I'd like to give a shout out to Martha Hodes's book, Mourning Lincoln. Drew a lot from her analysis here. And it's a book I strongly recommend. She went through thousands of letters, diaries, newspapers to see how people dealt with this event in 1865. So today we're going to do a little, kind of a little truncated version. I'm going to take all of you on a little tour around the United States in 1865. We're going to stop at 13 different places to see how people from different walks of life reacted to Lincoln's assassination. So with that, let's start our tour. So we're actually starting a few miles away from where I'm coming to you from. I'm coming to you from my home in Arlington, Virginia, as we at Ford's Theater are unfortunately closed at the moment due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So coming to you from a few miles outside of Washington, D.C., capital city of the United States, and of course, during the Civil War, capital city of the United States. Also on the front lines of the Civil War. So I'm coming to you from about 3 miles as the crow flies from Ford's Theater in Virginia. Virginia was one of the states that tried to leave the United States in 1861. So a lot of fighting during the Civil War took place all over North America, but a lot of fighting took place in between Washington and Richmond. But on April 9th, 1865, Robert E. Lee surrendered the main part of the Confederate Army. There were still Confederate troops in the field, but as you can probably imagine, in Washington, people were breathing a sigh of relief. The danger was mostly past. Next few nights, people were partying. And President Lincoln gave a speech in which he endorsed African-American voting rights for the first time. Very limited version, but he made that endorsement. And in the audience was an actor named John Wilkes Booth. Booth had been wanting to support the Confederate cause, and he saw an opportunity. While Lincoln gave that speech, Booth said, "That's the last speech he'll ever make." 3 nights later, he found his opportunity at Ford's Theater. Lincoln and President Lincoln, Mary Lincoln, and then Major Henry Rathbone and his fiancee Clara Harris went to the theater with Lincoln. And Booth shot Lincoln. Booth escaped out the back door. As I mentioned, he was captured 12 days later, 156 years ago today. A group of soldiers, in the meanwhile, carried Lincoln out the front door. They carried him across the street to the Peterson boarding house, where he passed away the next morning at 7:22 a.m. So immediately, word of Lincoln's assassination got out. This is what Ford's Theater looked like just after Lincoln's assassination. And here we already get a clue about how many people reacted. If you notice from the windows, there's hanging black cloth that's known as mourning crepe. That's to indicate that people are mourning somebody who has passed away. So in this picture, you see this actually happened in a lot of cities where stores ran out of black cloth. So over the next couple of weeks, the country's attention really shifted to two major things. One was the manhunt for John Wilkes Booth. And I mentioned how that ended. The other was burying President Lincoln. So a guy named George Harrington, who worked for the Treasury Department, was put in charge of the funeral for President Lincoln. Secretary of War Edwin Stanton had decided to send Lincoln's body to Springfield, Illinois, on a special funeral train that would stop in many different northern cities. In fact, First Lady Mary Lincoln had wanted just to send him straight to Springfield. Stanton said, nope, we need to have basically an elaborate state funeral. So Harrington's put in charge of that with the idea that there's first step is going to be a procession from the White House to the Capitol down Pennsylvania Avenue in Washington on April the 19th. So over the next few days, as Harrington is planning for this funeral, he gets a lot of letters. This is one of them. I'm going to zoom in on it to show you what it says. So this letter comes from the chairman of the Committee of Colored Citizens of Washington, who desire to participate in the funeral ceremonies of our late president and friend, Abraham Lincoln. I have to solicit the favor of being placed in such a position in the line of procession as you may assign. So, this is our first reaction here. So this is, you can guess from the name, it's the Committee of Colored Citizens. This is a group that's mostly African-American, and they are wanting to take part in the funeral procession. Now, notice something here too. They use the name Committee of Colored Citizens. African-American citizenship was a big question in 1865. And so they are saying, hey, you know, we are citizens of the United States. We are just as much a part of this country as anybody. In fact, this was an advocacy group. And, they're saying, hey, we consider Lincoln an ally. We want to take part in this. So I'm not sure if this particular group actually took part, but we do know that there were African-American marchers in the funeral procession a few days later. I'll give you another little factoid here about James Wormley, who was one of the leaders of the group. He's one of his descendants was actually recently nominated to be the Deputy Secretary of Commerce, and the Wormley family used to own the land that the Department of Commerce now sits on today. So little past-present connection there in Washington, D.C. So in fact, a couple of days later, funeral of Lincoln took place down Pennsylvania Avenue, and then Lincoln's body loaded onto a train and touring through the North. So now, little question I always like to ask folks is, how do you get breaking news today? So, I personally, a lot of times, I get a notification on this or a notification online. In fact, folks told me just before this, make sure you turn off all your notifications before this program. But, in 1865, we had some similar, some different ways of getting breaking news. So, in 1865, some people heard through word of mouth. Others heard in the newspaper. But also, some people heard pretty quickly, some people didn't. That was because by 1865, we had the telegraph. So, today we think of the telegraph as a pretty outdated piece of technology. But in 1865, it was still kind of revolutionary. It had only been around since 1844, so it's 21 years. We'd actually had the telegraph in 1865 for less time than we have had the internet in 2021. And just as in 1865, just as today, we hear about the digital divide, where some people have easy access to high-speed internet, which is useful, say, in a pandemic when people need to go to school and work at home. Others don't have access to high-speed internet. Similarly, in 1865, we're going to see a bit of a divide in how quickly people learned about the Lincoln assassination, whether or not they were near a telegraph line. So with that, let's step on our tour. This is going to be a rapid-fire tour around the continent in 1865. First stop is Boston, Massachusetts. So Boston is a city on the telegraph line, and a major northern city, had been a hotbed of abolitionism before the war. And so This is the diary of a 13-year-old girl named Sarah Gould Putnam. This diary is held by the Massachusetts Historical Society today. They contributed it to the Remembering Lincoln website. So let's see what Sarah Gould Putnam had to say about Lincoln's assassination. She says, "Now guess my feelings when coming down to breakfast. As mother saying, the president is killed. I stood so for a few minutes without speaking. I cannot realize it yet. Poor dear old Abe." So, you know, she's expressing her surprise here. She's a little shocked. She comes down to breakfast and she hears this big news. And then notice she says, "I stood so for a few minutes without speaking." But she doesn't just tell us in her words how she reacted. One of the things I love about this diary is that she also drew the look on her face. So similar to today, how we, when we communicate, say, via text message, we use emoji because words don't always convey the emotion that we're trying to express, not in the same way as, you know, when you can see our faces, for example. So in this case, she is communicating not just through her words, but with the expression on her face. One of the things I also love about this source is that she grew up to be a portrait painter. Go figure. So she's already expressing herself artistically in her diary. All right. So next stop on our little rapid fire tour is Cleveland, Ohio. So Cleveland is also a northern city. Ohio was one of the states that did not try to leave the United States in 1861. But sometimes we forget that, you know, places are divided. People are divided on certain things. So we see this happen in Cleveland. So Cleveland's on the telegraph line. They find out the morning of Lincoln's assassination that this has happened. And at 9 a.m. that morning, the mayor of Cleveland issues this proclamation saying that people should come to Public Square at 3 o'clock, that's the main square in Cleveland, to show how they feel about Lincoln's assassination. By the way, all of these sources here are from the Western Reserve Historical Society in Cleveland. But when people get there, not everyone's in the same mood. So this this newspaper headline here gives us a little clue. It's kind of hard to see, I realize, on the screen. I'll blow up a part of the article in a moment. It says, "Traitors at home." So you can already guess what some sentiments were a bit. And let's see one of those in particular. So this is a clip from that article saying, "The case of J.J. Husband, the well-known architect who occupies an office and rooms over Fogg's store, was most prominent. He was in high glee over the news, remarking to one man, 'You have had your day of rejoicing. Now I have mine.' To another, 'This is a good day for me.' And to a third, that Lincoln's death was a darned small affair, small loss. It seems that afterward, he became sensible of the danger he had incurred by these remarks, for he came sneaking to the newspaper offices to deny that he had made them. We have, however, the authority of half a dozen reliable gentlemen who heard his remarks against his unsupported assertion." So, wow. So J.J. Husband gets up at this morning rally for Lincoln and says, "It's no small loss." So, you know, this is something to remember, that as we revere Lincoln today, a lot of people opposed him. I mean, for that matter, 11 states tried to leave the United States, at least the white populations did, while, you know, rather than live with Lincoln as president. He had a lot of opponents in the North, too. So apparently J.J. Husband was one of them. But also, talk about a case of bad timing. In fact, case of bad timing where my light just fell. But case of bad timing on J.J. Husband's part, where he, you know, he gets up and expresses this right as people are mourning Lincoln. So you can probably imagine how the crowd reacted. You know, he sneaks into the newspaper offices to say, "Oh, no, I never said that." So J.J. Husband is an architect. Architects design buildings. architects get their names on buildings. So J.J. Husband had designed the Cuyahoga County Courthouse. So this is the old cornerstone of the third Cuyahoga County Courthouse. It today is at the Western Reserve Historical Society in Cleveland. So let's see. You can see the county commissioner's names on it. You can see the contractor's names. And then you see a nice little blank line there. Well, that was where J.J. Husband's name once was. Crowd actually chiseled his name out of the courthouse cornerstone after his reaction to the Lincoln assassination. Go figure. All right. Next stop on our little tour is Nashville, Tennessee. So speaking of divided places, a lot of times when we think about the Civil War, we think about North-South as monoliths. But we just saw the North wasn't a monolith, and neither was the South. You know, for one thing, Black population, free and enslaved, support the Union, support the United States cause. The white population tended to be divided in a lot of states. Parts of East Tennessee actually, at one point, considered breaking away from Tennessee to stay with the Union, similar to how Western Virginia became the state of West Virginia. And also by 1865, the U.S. Army was in control of Nashville. So we can see this is a newspaper from Nashville in 1865. So Nashville is on the telegraph line. And this newspaper, for one thing, gives a little clue of its affiliation, the Nashville Union. So when we look at newspapers from the 19th century, something we have to remember too is that newspapers then were partisan. Newspapers wore their politics on their sleeves. Only later did the idea of, you know, middle of the road, quote unquote, objective journalism come up. So Nashville Union gives a bit of a hint as to how its official stance is. But also, this headline here, it's kind of hard to see, but it says, "The Rebel Fiends at Work." The Rebel Fiends. So this is something that happens whenever we have an event like Lincoln's assassination. We see this today, where the question is always, okay, who or what is to blame for this event? Is it the individual? Is it the cause that they're a part of? Is it somewhere in between? You know, the case of the Lincoln assassination, it was a, you know, it was a conspiracy, but the question was how deep did the conspiracy go? And did those who supported the cause for which Booth struck, were they responsible for it? You know, this newspaper here is saying, hey, essentially it's not just Booth, but it's the cause that he supports. So again, you know, those lines can be really hard to draw. Right, so next stop on our little rapid fire tour is Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. So Philadelphia is in, it's Union territory, country, Pennsylvania did not try to leave the United States in 1861. And Philadelphia is home to a large free African-American community, including a woman named Emily Davis. So Emily Davis kept a diary during parts of the Civil War. And in fact, that diary today is at the Historical Society of Pennsylvania. And a team from Villanova University, led by Professor Judy Giesberg, actually digitized this whole diary. So you can read all of her diary today. So let's see what Emily Davis had to say about Lincoln's assassination. So she says, Friday, April 14th, "Today is the day we celebrate the soldiers' parade. A flag was presented to the regiment by somebody. Very pleasant. Everybody seemed to have a holiday." So this is something that we see in really a lot of people's writings in 1865. So Friday, for one thing, is Good Friday. It's also, you know, this is 5 days after Robert E. Lee has surrendered. This is the same day that the U.S. flag is raised at Fort Sumter on the fourth anniversary of its surrender in 1861. So this is a time of jubilation for a lot of people. And then the news of Lincoln's assassination comes. So on Saturday, Emily Davis says, "Very sad news was received this morning of the murder of the president. The city is in deep mourning. We had a meeting of the association." So you can see a roller coaster of emotions here on Emily Davis's part, going from jubilation Friday to sadness on Saturday. And also notice she talks about an association. Yeah, there were many different African-American groups, many different associations at this time. In fact, go to the Colored Conventions Project to see some of their advocacy. And then Sunday, she says, we decided to postpone the fair. Very fine day. Everyone seems to partake of the solemnity of the times. Dr. Jones spoke for us. So, you know, again, that somberness right there. And Sunday was Easter as well. So something that we'll mention in a moment. Right. So now we are going to go partway across the continent to Salt Lake City in Utah Territory. So Utah was not yet a state in 1865. Salt Lake City was on the telegraph line. In fact, there was a telegraph line at that time going all the way out to San Francisco. So San Francisco actually found out about Lincoln's assassination on the day that it happened. And Salt Lake City finds out then as well. So this is a news item that actually, in fact, a graduate student at West Virginia University found and contributed to the Remembering Lincoln website. And this newspaper talks about a meeting of some elders of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, of the Mormon Church, talking about Lincoln's assassination. So I'm going to blow up one of those examples right here. So we have Elder George Cannon here. So Elder George Q. Cannon followed upon the same subject on Lincoln's assassination and also reviewed the once unhappy sadness that prevailed in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, consequent upon the perpetration of a like wicked but more dastardly act of cruel murder done in cold blood. So, you know, just even reading this, we can tell, okay, he's making a reference to something. And this is something that we do today, you know, that we all do. Whenever something like Lincoln's assassination or some major event happens, we think of what this reminds us of, whether in our individual memory or in our collective memory. So in this case, he's referring to the murder 21 years before of Joseph Smith, of the prophet of the Mormon Church, who a mob had murdered. So in this case too, he's saying, you know, even more dastardly act of cruel murder, maybe a mob versus an individual gunman, you know, done in cold blood. So, you know, and this is something that we see a lot today. In fact, Professor Hodes talked about being inspired to write the book Mourning Lincoln by thinking back on the attacks of September 11th, 2001. And I know that when I've read certain reactions to the Lincoln assassination, I think back to where I was on September 11th, 2001. And I think we probably have a lot of moments like that from the past year as well. Right. And I see that we have a question coming in here. So yeah, just also a reminder for everybody who's watching at home, you can drop your questions into the chat on Facebook and YouTube, and they will be conveyed to me. So as they conveyed by a person, Juliana Lauren in particular. So I see we have a question about any books geared toward middle grade readers on Lincoln's assassination and reactions. There are some good books for middle grade readers. And also remember Lincoln website, we do have some lessons for middle grade readers. I will say that probably the best books are Chasing Lincoln's Killer and James Swanson wrote another really good one for middle grade readers too. Sorry, James, I don't remember the title. Bloody Times, that was it. So, all right. So, next up on our tour is Troy, New York. So Troy's also on the telegraph line. And we're talking about Emily Davis. Remember how I mentioned that Sunday was Easter Sunday. So all around the country, priests and ministers got up on their pulpits and they talked about the the significance of Lincoln's assassination. And in fact, we have about 100 different reactions, different sermons on the Remembering Lincoln website. And this one comes from a minister in Troy, New York. I should add that we also have some from rabbis. This was during Passover as well. So this is what a minister, Reverend Jacob Thomas in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, what he had to say about Lincoln's assassination. A few days ago, joy and gladness filled every heart. All who were loyal to the government rejoiced and gave thanks to Almighty God because of the victory won, the downfall of the rebel capital. The intelligence was too glorious to be unalloyed. Ere our joy had subsided, sorrow overtook us. News reached us from Washington of the bloody deed perpetrated there. We could not believe it. It could not be possible that a creature in the form of man could be found so God-forsaken as to take the life of the man who had malice for none, but charity for all. So, you know, we see Reverend Thomas here expressing what a lot of people expressed, that that roller coaster of emotions. And indeed, a lot of people found religious significance in Lincoln's assassination. You know, some like Thomas talking about, you know, we went from joy to mourning, and, you know, finding a creature so God-forsaken. But a lot of comparisons as well of Lincoln to Moses. The idea that Moses got to the cusp of the promised land. He actually could look over the mountain into the promised land, but not actually get there. There were also some ministers, priests, and rabbis who said, you know, okay, maybe Lincoln was the right one to get us through the Civil War. Is he the right one to get us through Reconstruction? You know, what's God's will on this? You know, a lot of people were really wondering about the role of the divine in this event. Others saw Lincoln as an immediate martyr ascending to heaven. So this is a card that floated around a lot in 1865, showing Lincoln ascending to heaven, created by George Washington. Go figure. Right, so the next stop on our little tour is Davenport, Iowa. Now, this actually gets into one of Lincoln's most controversial actions as president. So Davenport's at least near a telegraph line. And this is a letter that today is in the collections of the Minnesota Historical Society. It's a letter from a man named Maurice Idewakendioda, and I apologize for the pronunciation. I unfortunately don't speak the Dakota language. But his name translates into English as Moses Many Lightning Face. This letter is in the Dakota language. So it's actually translated by a man for the Minnesota Historical Society. So going to read what he has to say and then talk a bit about the context. So Moses Many Lightning Face writes and says, "They have said that the president was killed. But someone of authority should tell us if this is not true. Thus, my relative, I write to you this letter. Also, I have heard several rumors. Therefore, I want to write you this letter. It is so. The president has compassion for us, as so far we are still alive. But now they told us he was killed, and we are saddened. Those of us here think if this is so, we are heartbroken. Perhaps the attitude of the cavalry soldiers may change toward us. Tell me what your thoughts are. I want to know. That's why I write to you. Then I wish to hear exactly how they killed the president." So what's going on here? So you notice he says, talking about the attitude of the cavalry soldiers, and he says that we are still alive. So 3 years before this, in 1862, the U.S. and the Dakota had gone to war in southwestern Minnesota. Lincoln sent in troops, some of them fresh off Civil War battlefields, defeated the Dakota, captured over 300 of them, and they went on trial before a military tribunal, and over 300 death sentences handed down. Lincoln personally reviewed the death sentences. He decided to allow 38 of them to go through. In fact, those 38, this was the largest mass execution in U.S. history, executed in Mankato on December 26, 1862. And then the rest of them, Lincoln had sent out of Minnesota, mainly to keep Minnesota state authorities from doing anything to them, sent them to a prisoner of war camp for the next 3 years in Davenport, Iowa. But two, you notice Moses Many Lightning Face says, he has mercy for us that we are still alive. Because Lincoln did not actually officially commute the death sentences. He simply prevented them from being carried out, from prevented the federal government from carrying them out. So in 1865, they are still living in limbo, trying to figure out what happened, what's going on. So you know, this is a case too where we don't know the future. So in this case, the following year, President Andrew Johnson did release the prisoners. But they, nonetheless, in 1865, they don't know what's going on. So, all right. Next stop on our little tour is Demopolis, Alabama. So Alabama was one of the states that tried to leave the United States in 1865. And, I mentioned that the press in that day was very partisan, wore their politics on their sleeve. Well, we see this in Demopolis, Alabama. This is a piece that comes to us from the Alabama Department of Archives and History. So this is a headline in the Alabama Beacon reprinted from the Demopolis Herald. Also, newspapers tended to simply reprint each other at that time. Notice the headline here, "Glorious News. Lincoln and Seward Assassinated." But then the next one, "Lee Defeats Grant." And then says, "Andy Johnson Inaugurated President." Lee defeats Grant, huh? This is something where whenever we look at a piece from the past, we always have to bring our own knowledge to bear. We have to bring further context. And in this case, like if you saw this in the archive, you're like, wait, Lee defeats Grant, what? So, obviously this is a case, this might be wishful thinking. And one of the things I love about this article too, is that they're transparent about their sources. They say that this is hearing from a telegraph operator in Demopolis who heard from a telegraph operator, believe in Selma, who heard from a guy passing through town that Lee had actually managed to meet up with Joseph Johnston's army and together they had soundly whipped Grant. And this is said to be true beyond a doubt. Obviously not the case. Instead of Lee defeating Grant, 10 days before this, Lee had surrendered to Grant. So this might be a case of a little bit of wishful thinking here. But two, this reflects whenever something big happens, we don't know what's happening. We have to be very careful with our sources and, who's telling us what is going on. All right. Next stop on our tour is Virginia City, Nevada. So now we're getting into later days of April 1865. So I'm not sure if Virginia City was on the telegraph line, but it's decently close to San Francisco. So probably finding out. And this this piece right here is from a newspaper called La Voz de México. It's in Spanish. And in fact, some of my friends at St. Mary's University, Professor Teresa Van Hoy's class, actually contributed this to the Remembering Lincoln website. And this piece is from a group called a Junta Patriótica, or a patriotic club. So David Hayes Bautista, in his book on Cinco de Mayo, found that there were all of these groups throughout the Southwest called Juntas Patrióticas. And they were there to... they were there to support not just the Union cause in the U.S. Civil War, but also Mexico was in the midst of a civil war at the time between people who wanted Mexico to remain a republic and those who wanted Mexico to become a monarchy. And in fact, the monarchists had gotten the French involved. They got Emperor Maximilian installed on the throne of Mexico. So the Juntas Patrióticas supported both the U.S. cause in the U.S. Civil War and the Republican cause in the Mexican Civil War, because they saw these as one and the same, that they were fights for democracy, fights for freedom against, you know, one system of slavery, other an aristocratic system. So this little bit of context on this piece from the Junta Patriótica in Virginia City, Nevada, of Mexican-American miners. And this is what one of them, Rafael Gonzalez, had to say. He says, "May the curse of all the Americas," the translation that Dr. Van Hoy's students provided, in fact, "may the curse of all the Americas fall on this cane for this evil of taking from the world this great citizen, the Northern Star and the guardian angel of all the Americas, to dare call tyrants all the accomplices of this assassination of a man who sacrificed his existence for the liberty of 4 million human beings." So you notice Rafael Gonzalez here is saying that Lincoln's cause, that Lincoln's legacy, isn't just for the United States, but for all of the Americas. So in fact, a lot of people made comparisons even then between Lincoln and the Republican president of Mexico, Benito Juarez. There was a city named Lincoln in Argentina later that year in 1865. And today there is a statue of Lincoln in Mexico City. In fact, I should have added my little selfie that I took in front of that statue a couple of years ago. All right. Next stop on our tour, getting toward the end, Boise in Idaho Territory. And this was 156 years ago yesterday. So Idaho's not yet a state. This is the Idaho Statesman newspaper. And I realize it's kind of hard to see on the screen, but it says at the top, "President Lincoln and Secretary Seward assassinated." 10 days later, they're saying this. So this kind of indicates to us that maybe they're not on the telegraph line. And indeed, this was the case. So the first paragraph says, "The Overland Mail arrived at about 3 o'clock this afternoon, bringing a large number of extras from the offices of the Daily Salt Lake Telegraph of April 15th, bearing dispatches that President Lincoln and Secretary Seward were both assassinated." So we can see here where, they're not on the telegraph. Salt Lake City, as we saw, is. So basically, news got to Salt Lake City on April 15th. The newspaper appropriately called the Telegraph, printed its edition, they're loaded onto a stagecoach and sent up to Boise, and they get there 10 days later. And only then do the people of Boise find out that Lincoln's been assassinated. So, in fact, there's a story that I know that Juliana and Lauren are putting into the chat about how this newspaper was long thought lost and found a little while ago. And the former lieutenant governor of Idaho actually contributed it to the Idaho State Historical Society, who then contributed it to the Remembering Lincoln collection. So, all right. And there goes my light again. I clearly need to get a better suction cup here. All right. So our next stop is Virginia City, another Virginia City, this one being in Montana Territory. So we're going to see how a girl named Mary Sheehan Ronan, who's a teenager at the time, how she reacted to the assassination when she found out in late April 1865. But the voice that we're going to hear from her is different from the voice we've heard from everyone else. So far, we've only seen what people said at the time. In fact, Professor Hodes based her book on what people said at the time, because, you know, we tend to remember things differently later on. So in Mary Sheehan Ronan's case, we're going to see what she wrote about it later in life. So what does she have to say? This is her memoir in 1929. And she says, "It pains me to recall what we did when we were told of Lincoln's death. The news reached Virginia City in April 1865. The Southern girls, by far the majority, picked up their ankle-length skirts to their knees and jigged and hippity-hopped around and around the room. they cheered for the downfall of that great, good, simple man, whom they had been taught to regard as the arch enemy of the South. They believed him the first and last cause of any and every misfortune that had befallen their parents and driven them to seek new fortunes amid the hardships of a far western frontier. When my playmates called, "Come on, Molly, come on, join the dance. You're from Kentucky, you're a Southerner," I did join half-heartedly with a guilty feeling. At home that evening, I told what we had done. My father was shocked. "I am ashamed of you, Molly," he said. "I am a Democrat, but I am first, last, and always for the Union and for Lincoln." So, wow. So she's talking about her and her friends dancing around with jubilation at Lincoln's assassination. Now, she also gives a hint about who's around her. You know, referring to them as Southerners, you know, presumably white Southerners here. And notice the name of the town, Virginia City. So a few years before, a group of white Southerners had founded this town, and they originally wanted to name it Verena, for Verena Davis, the wife of Confederate President Jefferson Davis. As you can imagine, the U.S. Postal Service was not particularly fond of that idea. So they said, okay, fine, we'll name it Virginia City. But also notice here, she's writing this in 1929. This is 7 years after the Lincoln Memorial was dedicated. And the dedication speeches for the Lincoln Memorial were all about this idea of national reconciliation, of bringing, at least in this case, white North, white South together. Not so much advocating, talking about Lincoln as emancipator. By then, many former Confederates had really said, yeah, we like Lincoln. D.W. Griffith, who directed the notoriously racist Birth of a Nation in 1915, had a fairly sympathetic portrayal of Lincoln in that film. And the year after Mary Sheehan Ronan wrote this memoir, he actually released a very flattering biopic of Lincoln. So, you know, she's writing this in 1929 at a time when Lincoln is revered. You know, I whenever I show this to students, I always ask the hypothetical question, do you think she would have written the same in her diary in 1865 as she wrote in this memoir in 1929? Yeah, no right or wrong answer. We don't have her diary, as far as I know. But you know, that's something we always have to consider when we read somebody's words way later on. People's memories are imperfect. People's memories change. People have reasons too, like, oh, you know, kind of ashamed I did that. So you can see how she's really couching that here. And by the way, this comes to us from the Montana Historical Society. And our friend Kristen Gallus referred us to this piece. All right. So actually our second to last stop on our tour is Avery Island, Louisiana. So you might recognize the name Avery Island if you have a bottle of Tabasco sauce nearby. The Avery Island was actually the name of a plantation owned by the Avery family in Louisiana. A few years after the Civil War, they started bottling a tonic made of Tabasco pepper that, in fact, they might have actually learned about from some of the enslaved people around them. Started bottling it and producing it and shipping it from Avery Island, where Tabasco sauce still comes from. So, you know, this is this letter here is another reminder that we can't predict the future. So whenever we look at the past, we always have to remember that just like how we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, much less way in the future, neither did other people. So this letter is from the plantation owner named Dudley Avery. He's writing to his son. Caleb McDaniel, who's a history professor at Rice University, let me know about this letter. And blow up what he has to say. He says, "My views in regard to the assassination of Lincoln are the same as yours. I think that in the present condition of the country, it is a misfortune to the South." By this, he means the Confederate supporters. He says, "Johnson, the new president, seems to be a man void of principle and honor. And if he is not restrained by the conservative party at the North, he will out Herod Herod." And that's a reference to the biblical era king of Israel, who's known to be a tyrant. So what's he saying here? You know, he's saying that he thinks, hey, you know, Lincoln might have been pretty merciful on us. Lincoln might have just, you know, let us get away with rebelling against the United States. And Johnson, he's going to come down really harsh on us. Well, you know, again, we don't know the future. In this case, Andrew Johnson wound up being about the opposite of what Dudley Avery predicted. You know, for example, Alexander Stevens was vice president of the Confederacy in May of 1865. And December of 1865, he was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives again. President Johnson basically started to hand out pardons left and right to former Confederates and said, okay, you guys can't do slavery, but yeah, do whatever. So many states passed restrictive black codes where they tried to put African Americans in a state of almost slavery. So, you know, far from, you know, in this case, you know, Dudley Avey's perspective, far from punishing, Johnson did the opposite. That was where Congress said, we're going to, we're taking this over here. So, you know, again, we don't know the future, but, you know, this raises the question too, of what should happen after a civil war? What should happen after a time of deep division? That's always a question for a society. So we see Dudley Avery's answer here, apparently. All right. So our final stop is Springfield, Illinois. This is Lincoln's hometown. On May 4th, 1865, Lincoln was buried there in a tomb. And this piece right here looks like ordinary stuff. It really is. This is a shadow box built by a guy named S.S. Elder. Coincidentally, he was a welder. Don't know if his rhyming last name had anything to do with him going to the welding profession. But, you know, these are some of his ordinary work tools. But on May 4th, 1865, he got a special assignment. His job was to seal President Lincoln's coffin. So he did that. And then he saved the tools that he had used, because these ordinary work tools were now special because of what he had used them for. He put them into the shadow box. He passed this down through his family. He also put a ticket to Lincoln's funeral and a picture of Lincoln that's now really faded. Eventually, his family donated this to Ford's Theater. So I always like to show this because I've had the privilege of touching it before when we opened up an exhibit case. But today, this is at Ford's Theater. And this is, you know, these ordinary artifacts are here because they were associated with something extraordinary, the Lincoln assassination. Well, all of us have lived through some pretty extraordinary times this past year plus. So how will people tell that story in 156 years? Well, there are a lot of groups that want to know how we are reacting today. So in fact, there's a group that put together the Journal of the Plague Year, an archive of COVID-19. So know that Juliana and Lauren are going to put this into the comments on Facebook and YouTube. And you can contribute what you are experiencing this year. So, you know, they want to know. So that way people in the future can see how ordinary people like us are dealing with this year. And similarly, many of the pieces that I showed you today are conserved by state and local historical societies, libraries, archives, museums. Similarly, the coalition of historic sites called Made by Us, housed at the Museum of American History, put together a map of over 450 different collecting efforts by different historical organizations who want to know how we are responding to COVID-19, racial reckoning, what happened on Capitol Hill, you know, all of the events of the past year. So you can go to their website and get links to all of these different collecting efforts. And if you want to know more about how people reacted to the Lincoln assassination, you can go to our Remembering Lincoln website, where you can see over 850 different reactions from around the country. And if there's a place that you know about, or if there's a reaction that you know about, let us know. You know, we have a little form you can fill out. Send me an email. And we'd love to know. We'd love to be able to continue to build this collection. So with that, I'm leaving it for questions. So I do see that we did get a question in already. One of you said the letter from Moses Many Lightning Face is powerful. I wonder who he means when he says they have said that the president was killed. That's a really good question. Yeah, I don't know. Could have been the soldiers. Could have been, you know, he's writing to a missionary in Minnesota. He could have heard from anyone. That's a really good question. I'm really not sure. So do we have any other questions coming in? Ah, could I talk a little bit about how Lincoln's death served as a placeholder for national mourning? Someone was wondering if it was helpful. That's a really good question. So, in fact, a book that I'd recommend is called This Republic of Suffering by the historian Drew Gilpin Faust. So she's actually looked at a lot of the culture of death of the Civil War. And, you know, what she talks about, what Professor Hodes talks about, that, you know, with Lincoln's death, you know, this is something we have to remember. Sometimes we treat this in isolation, but this was at the end of 4 years of a lot of dying. That, you know, it would, like, the percentage of the population killed in the Civil War would be the equivalent of about 7 million today. So, you know, this was, you know, so in a lot of ways, Lincoln stood in for a lot of people. You know, people said, they say that it was kind of almost a catharsis for, especially there was a popular song, I now have a Ralph Stanley version of it going in my head, called This Vacant Chair. And it was the idea that, you know, so many families had lost people during this. So Lincoln in some ways became kind of a stand-in for that national mourning. So, I mean, it's estimated that a huge percentage of the population of the northern United States saw Lincoln's coffin pass by, or, you know, went to the different services in different cities. So, I mean, this was really probably a pretty smart idea on Secretary of War Stanton's part to do this national mourning right here. So, as yep, person is wondering if was it helpful? Might very well have been. Do you have any other questions coming in? Not yet. All right. As I said, you know, encourage you to go check out the Remembering Lincoln website. Any other books that you'd recommend as I search? Ah, great question. Okay. Yes. Any other books you'd recommend? Strongly recommend the book Manhunt by James Swanson. It's a really great one where he gives you a lot of the facts and does it as a page turner. Also, you know, again, strongly, strongly, strongly recommend Mourning Lincoln. Also, if you'd like to know more about Booth himself and some of his motives, Terry Alford spent around 30 years doing a biography of John Wilkes Booth. It's called Fortune's Fool. Also, Tom Bogar did a book called Backstage at the Lincoln Assassination. And this book looks into the staff of Ford's Theater. So he put a lot of books either go out the back door with Booth or out the front door with Lincoln. He stays in the theater. So yeah, a lot of good books out there. Also, I'd strongly recommend reading about Reconstruction. In fact, another book I'd recommend is called They Knew Lincoln by John Washington. John Washington actually grew up around the corner from Ford's Theater in the 1880s and 1890s. And he was an African-American man, lived in his grandmother's boarding house, remembered his grandmother and her friends talking about their lives during the Civil War, their interactions with Lincoln, even. And in 1942, he published this as a book. The historian Kate Mazur just brought the book out again a couple of years ago, brought it back into print. It was out of print for several decades. Strongly recommend that book. Have there been any investigations into international reactions to Lincoln's assassination? That's a great question. So we do have some on the Remembering Lincoln website. Also, the U.S. State Department, their Office of the Historian, did actually compile, the State Department in the 1860s, compiled all of the different official, official statements of mourning they got from around the world. The State Department's Office of the Historian digitized those a few years ago. So you can check those out. Also, if I remember correctly, the historian Don Doyle is working on a book on international reactions to the Lincoln assassination. It's kind of a sequel to his book, which is another one I strongly recommend, called The Cause of All Nations, looking at international implications with the U.S. Civil War. So actually also, one more book I'll add is David Hayes Bautista's on Cinco de Mayo. So, all right. Well, I'm getting the prompt that sounds like we are good to wrap up. So just like to thank everybody for taking an hour of your afternoon with me today. And I hope this was informative and valuable. And, we're always happy to take some more questions. And just, like to say, thank you for coming.